There I am in my Masked Avenger hat and goggles, which I got off my friend in a trade. And then there were my father and mother, two people who could find an argument in any subject.
Wait a minute. Are you telling me you think the Atlantic is a greater ocean than the Pacific?
No, have it your way. The Pacific is greater.
I mean, how many people fight over oceans? Then there was my Uncle Abe. He kept bringing home fish from his friends who worked at Sheepshead Bay.
Seal! I'm home! Seal! I got fish! I had great fish today.
Radio Days, your most recent film to open in Britain, is a nostalgic story about growing up in Brooklyn in the days before television. With a huge cast and period sets, it's quite a contrast to a chamber piece like Hannah and Her Sisters. Do you enjoy filmmaking on a larger scale?
I don't enjoy the big... Radio Days was hard for me because there's a lot of, logistics with 200 people and various sets and mob scenes and many costumes. Occasionally, I get an idea that necessitates that, but I'd much prefer to do smaller films because it's just easier physically.
Recently, the way you've made your film seems more and more like the process of writing. You shoot a first draft, as it were, work on it a bit, then go back for some more filming.
I've always worked that way, really. Right from the first picture I ever directed, the Take the Money and Run, I worked that way. I didn't know I was working that way. I mean, I wrote it and worked on it, shot it, and then noticed many things wrong, went back and reshot them again. And you can have the luxury of doing that if you're able to work within a small budget. Because the film I just finished now, I shot the entire film from start to finish. I edited it and looked at it and didn't like it. And shot the entire film again from start to finish. I threw out everything, the whole thing. I didn't save a single frame from the original. And it still is a very modest budget film. It's not necessarily a wonderful film either, but if you stay within a limited budget, nobody bothers you.
Well, I get the feeling that in recent years, you don't want the Woody Allen character to be in it, that someone else can do that work now. Directing and writing, yes, but that you're marginalizing the Woody Allen character.
Yes, I'd like to spend a little more time directing. That's why I was not in Radio Days. I was not in the film as yet to come out that follows Radio Days. And I'm not going to be in the film that I'm planning to shoot this fall. Because I don't want to be in every film, and I don't want to make every film a comic film. I'd like to make the next of the next 10 or 15 or whatever films I make. I'd like to make, half of them quite serious films, and that would eliminate me immediately because I wouldn't want to be in a serious film as an actor because I don't think I could do it and wouldn't want to anyhow.
Well, I think you probably could, but the audience wouldn't accept it.
They wouldn't accept me, and I'm not sure that I could, that I wouldn't be too inhibited to really get too emotional on the screen.
You got a good sense of humor. You actually do.
Hey, thanks. I don't need you to tell me that, I've been making good money off it for years.
If you had to sum up Woody Allen, what would you say?
Just a very paradoxical, enigmatic, almost crazy person who understands himself well enough to know that he's not crazy enough to waste his gifts, but crazy enough to see things a little off, and somehow instructed by whatever force there is in nature that governs these things, however you want to define it, to let the rest of us see it too. And he respects that talent. He will do nothing in the way of short-circuiting that talent. It's his gift. And he knows it's cause for his anxiety, but it's also cause for his success.
I don't feel that I've made a great film yet in my life. I hope I will make at least one and maybe a couple. But I don't think, if one's standards for great films are, The Bicycle Thief and Grand Illusion, I'd like to be remembered as someone who made at least one, if not one or two, really great films.
Nevertheless, you've been quoted as saying,
I wish someone would come in and tell me I can't make films anymore. Is that true?
It would be sort of a load off my mind. I'd like to write books. But it seems such a shame not to make films while people are willing to finance them, because everyone wants to make films, and people are giving me millions of dollars to make these films, to put them on. So I figure someday I'll be old and enfeebled and won't want to get up in the morning and do it, and I'll write the books then. But it would not bother me if someone said tomorrow, you can never make another film. I mean, I'd probably get up in the morning relieved and relaxed, and because I enjoy writing.
Handsome man never did anything for me.
No.
You know what turns me on?
No.
Intellectual.
Really?
And I'm not just saying this to make you feel good or anything. You're a smooth talker.
Yeah.
Angelina once even predicted I would marry a Jew.
Did you happen to say which Jew?
I have a picture in my mind of Woody Allen and Mia Farrow surrounded these days by pets and children and homes and domestic life, which is a very long way away from the Woody Allen of old that audiences tend to associate with you. Has there been a dramatic change?
Well, no, because Mia and I don't live together. She is surrounded by kids and pets, and I live by myself across the park, and we see each other quite frequently, but no, I'm still as I was. I do play with the kids all the time, but then I never have to be there when the diapers are changed or anything, you know, really awful happens.
Do you still hold your same views of the countryside that your characters always hold? Because I know Mia Farrow has a place in Connecticut.
Yes, and it's always a sore point between us. She loves it, and I can never bear to go to the country. I'm a strictly urban person still, and I have all the same old prejudices and
the crickets make you nervous and all that.
The crickets make me nervous, definitely.
And you're soon to become a father for the first time, for which, congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
Do you hope that he or she is going to be a chip off the old Woody, as it were?
I hope it's a she. That's the first thing. I mean, that would be very important to me. And, I just hope, you know, I hope it's a she and that she's healthy. That's all I really care about. The rest is unimportant.